We move on to the next talk, which is by Sergio Ferrara, and it's about supergravity and inflation. In my glasses, supersymmetry and inflation. Right. Yes. Do you know how to start? Technical assistance. The microphone? You didn't put the microphone on.
Hello?
Try? Does it work?
Okay. I would like to thank Professor Ruffini, who gave me the opportunity of talking for the third time in this Marcel Grossman meeting. The first time it was at the very beginning in 1981 in Shanghai, China. The second time was here in 2000 in the second meeting which was held at the University of Rome. In 1981, I gave a plenary speech on the structure of supergravity. Supergravity was just born a few years before, and people were just working out possibility of writing interactions and also of extending supersymmetry to many superchargers, what is called today extended supersymmetry. In 2000, it was after the string revolution and also after the very crucial paper of Maldacena about the IEDS conformal field theory correspondence. And in all these developments, supersymmetry played an instrumental role. It plays a role even today in the description of ultraviolet divergences of amplitudes in Yamis theory and in supergravity, as we heard in the talk by Swinburne. However, it is interesting that it is natural, if you think that there is some supersymmetry at the very beginning of the universe, which was unbroken, it is obvious that you have to study the evolution of the universe in a supersymmetric context. So my talk today will mainly give some guidelines and some constraints on inflationary models, and I think much more you will hear from the talk of John Ellis later on in this sessions. The content of my seminar is written there. I apologize that sometimes I will use a language which is not common in general relativity, but I hope to give you some feeling of some general feature. I will discuss more general feature than particular details. So first of all, in supersymmetric theories, you have granted to have scalar fields. That is a nice thing about supersymmetric theories. So every time you have some fundamental reason to have a scalar field, supersymmetry plays a role. This is the case of the standard model with the Higgs field, which was mass is very low. And it is an indirect possibility of evidence for supersymmetric completion, even if no supersymmetry has been found in the TV scale up to now in the first round of LHC. But the other case is, in fact, inflaton, where also a scalar field plays an important role. And this scalar field is what is usually called the inflaton, and is the simplest way of describing inflaton in an evolution of the universe in a Friedmann-Lemaître-Robinson worker geometry. So a fundamental scalar field seems to be needed both in the particle physics scenario from the discovery of the Higgs field, which implies that the standard model is a spontaneously broken phase of an unabelian Yamil's theory, and also in the case of cosmology, where the inflaton plays a crucial role in order to explain some physical results from recent and later experiments. The simplest model, which was actually in difficulty after BICEP 2 experiment, but which has been revived after Planck mission corrected this result, is the so-called Sarobinsky model, which is called also R plus R square extension of general relativity. In this model predicts a unique inflaton potential, and the inflaton potential is given by the formula which you find there, and V0 is related to the Hubble scale in Planck units. And this model has the interesting fact that it has is essentially a parameter-free model. There is only V0 in this model. And it predicts the slow roll parameters which are in the experimental range. I don't have the time here to explain this slow roll parameter. Just let me remind you that the spectral index of scalar perturbation and the tensor to scalar ratio is given in terms of this capital N, which is related to the number of refolding at the end of inflation. This, if N is taken between 50 and 60, this model, the model I wrote before, predict, or if you want, is in complete agreement with these parameters. The interesting fact about supersymmetry, which will come in a moment, is that there is a continuous family of potentials which generalize the R plus R square model, which interpolates between the Sarobinsky model and what is called chaotic inflation, which now is not favored by experiment, but from a theoretical point of view, is interesting that this parameter alpha, which I wrote in the potential, enter in the tensor to scalar ratio, and for alpha large, if you take a suitable limit, it just become 8 over n, which is the scalar to tensor to scalar ratio predicted by chaotic inflation, which was one of the first models proposed by Linde with the quadratic potential. The recent 2015 data analysis favor an S to be around 0.97 and R less than 0.1. And the previous expression can be further generalized introducing arbitrary monotonic increasing functions. This is small f of hyperbolic tangent. And this potential for phi large approach the Sarobinsky potential. And this is what led to introduce this word of alpha tractors by Carlos Linde and Rust in subsequent developments. Up to now, I never talk about supersymmetry. The interesting fact about supersymmetry is that it restricts the class of scalar potential, but also there is another embarrassment that in supersymmetry you have more than one scalar potential, one scalar field. So the inflaton usually is accompanied by other fields. The simplest example, a chiral multiplet contains two scalars, and you have to decide which one is the inflaton. Now this is a non-trivial task because the potential in supersymmetric theories is not an arbitrary function, but it comes by some non-trivial construction. And this construction must give rise to a potential which is compatible with the potential for inflation in single field inflation, which is the one favored by experiments. So in the sequel, I will report on the framework on which you study this. Essentially, you have to study this in supergravity, and the simplest case is n equal 1 supergravity, which is also the only one which is compatible with the possible extension of the standard model to a supersymmetric extension. So the assumption here is that when you go toward the beginning of the universe, there is no higher supersymmetry explored, at least not in the inflationary phase. So we will assume that you have n equal 1 framework all the way from inflation to the exit of inflation. Then the scalar potential in this theory is related to the supergravity setting. So you have multiplets, the graviton multiplets with the gravitino, you have chiral multiplet, and you have a vector multiplet. And then you have a general formula for the Lagrangian, and the part which is interesting for inflation is the part which contains the kinetic term of the scalar field, which are complex scalar. This is the Einstein term, and this is the potential. And the nice fact is supersymmetry restricts the potential, and the potential is given by this formula. It contains some object. This D term has to do with the gauging of some isometries. This is what is called the F term, and this minus 3 here, which is a negative contribution to the potential, is related to the fact that supergravity can have an unbroken phase in anti-de-Sitter space. The potential can be recast in a more compact form in this way. This is called the F term, this is the D term, and this is this negative contribution due to the possibility of having also unbroken supersymmetry. Now, you understand here that there is a problem. If you want to find an inflaton potential, you need a way of canceling this term. Because this term, if it dominates, it will give you an anti-de-Sitter geometry, which would be a disaster for inflation. You want a de-Sitter geometry, rather anti-de-Sitter. This can be achieved in two ways. Either you have a D-term inflation where the D-term contribution is positive and then it allows a de-Sitter phase. Either you have a cancellation of a negative term from the F-term, and this happens in a variety of models in supergravity which are called non-scale models and which I think will be a main subject of John Ellis' talk. But from a general point of view, the inflaton potential needs an extra ingredient, which is the fact of getting rid of this negative huge contribution to the potential, which favors anti-de-Sitter the geometry, because in fact, those are the ones which you can have even with unbroken supersymmetry. On the other hand, we know that if you have a de-Sitter phase, this de-Sitter phase will break supersymmetry from general principle. And the reason is that if you have a de-Sitter space is incompatible with supersymmetry in four dimensions. So the de-Sitter phase is always a phase where supersymmetry is broken. And since the supersymmetry is broken, it means that the contribution of this term, which I wrote before, either the F term or the D term, are non-zero in the inflationary phase, which has a de-Sitter plateau. So this is essentially what I said before. And as I said, the non-scale structure is the only way you can cancel this minus 3 factor in the scalar potential. So all the models of inflation in a supersymmetric context either are models where the inflaton potential is dominated by a D-term, or they have a non-scale structure in such a way that this term is canceled by some of this F-term contribution which I wrote before. Well, this, in fact, is exactly what happens if you take the supersymmetric completion of R plus R square supergravity. We know that in the case of Einstein theory, R plus R square is conformally equivalent to general relativity plus the scalar field with the potential, which is the potential I just wrote before. The supersymmetric version of this is that R plus R squared supergravity is dual to a standard supergravity with two chiral multiplets or with a massive vector multiplet. There are two possible choices. If you want to understand the reason of these choices, you have to attend one of these parallel sessions. I don't have the time to explain here. But these models have in common two facts. First of all, in the De Sitter, during inflation, they exactly reproduce the Starobinsky potential. But they have they are partially successful because at the end of the inflation, supersymmetry gets restored in the Minkowski vacuum. So this model describes in a nice way the inflationary phase, but are not ready to describe the exit of inflation, where you would like to encounter particle physics, and in particle physics, supersymmetry should be broken. So this model do not achieve the part of the breaking of supersymmetry at the end of inflation. There is a progress which has been made recently, especially by Carlos Linde and by Dallaga-Dasvirner, where they provided the models where you have two supersymmetry breaking scale, one which is essentially related to the Hubble scale during inflation, and the other which is related to a much lower scale which you get at the exit of inflation. The price you have to pay in order to do this is that you have to use for the Gostino sector, the sector which breaks supersymmetry, a non-linearization of supersymmetry. And I hope I will have a few minutes to describe this. The non-linearization is essentially a realization where a linear field, superfield, is replaced by a nilpotent superfield. Now, you see that if you would have not supersymmetry, nilpotency would be impossible. The reason why it's possible in supersymmetry is because you have Grassmann-valued fields. So S squared equals zero doesn't imply S equals zero, but just implies that this Gostino object, which is the scalar partner of the Gostino, is not a fundamental field and it is eliminated from the spectrum. What is interesting, this object is entirely equivalent to the original Volkov-Akulov Lagrangian. And when you couple Volkov-Akulov to an inflationary theory, you find what we call, in this paper with Antoniadis, Dudas, and Sagnotti, Volkov-Akulov Starobinsky supergravity, because it gives you the minimal model which contains the Starobinsky model. It contains just the inflaton. It contains a partner, which is an axion. But this axion is soon stabilized and get a large mass. So it doesn't participate to inflation. So let me jump. As I said, the minimal model for inflation are models where you have either D-term inflation or either you have F-term inflation. All these models have a property that they contain two scalar multiplets. Two chiral multiplets in one formulation of supergravity. This comes from what is called the old minimal formulation, and another formulation, which is the new minimal, they contain a massive vector multiplet. So you get always 8 degrees of freedom, 4 fermions and 4 scalar. So this is a counterintuitive, because you would think that the inflaton need only one chiral multiplet, but in fact this is not true. If you have a supersymmetric theory of inflation, you need two chiral multiplets. One multiplet contains the inflaton, and the other multiplet contains the Gostino sector. It's a sector responsible for supersymmetry. So let me go now to the question of having the possibility of having two supersymmetry breaking scale. As I told you, if you have two chiral multiplets, you have the R plus R squared theory, which is the one which I was describing before. You have always that at the end of inflation, the Starobinsky potential give you unbroken supersymmetry. So for instance, the D-term inflation at the exit of inflation The D term is zero, which means that supersymmetry is unbroken. It is possible to construct models where you have two scales of supersymmetry, and the two scales of supersymmetry in this model, which was constructed by Carlos and Linde, are given by this mass here, capital M, and this W0 constant. So there are two M and W0, two scale. And then what happens is that if you compute the potential has a zero vacuum energy. For large value of the scalar field, it gives you essentially the Starobinsky potential. For small value, it gives you a cosmological constant, which is given by this formula. So you see the cosmological constant, in order to be compatible with particle physics, must have an enormous fine-tuning, because this m to the 4 and W0 square are essentially of the order of the Hubble constant times the Planck scale. So in order to have a particle physics cosmological constant, you need a fine-tuning. The need of fine-tuning is an old problem, and we have still today know that we need the fine-tuning. There is no way of having naturally a small cosmological constant, but the interesting fact is that you can do it. So this model presented by Carlo Schellinde is the first model, to my knowledge, which has two supersymmetry breaking scale, and it has an inflationary region, and it has an exit of inflation, where the vacuum energy is given by the difference of a positive and negative term, so it can be set near to zero, but supersymmetry is broken. So the supersymmetry is broken. You can even supersymmetry broken Minkowski space. The price you have to pay is that the gravitino mass is very large, is of the order of the Hubble scale, and the supersymmetry breaking scale is intermediate between the Hubble scale and the Planck scale. The potential is given by this formula here. These are the F-term contribution of the of the inflaton field, which is zero during inflation. And this is the Gostino contribution, which is non-zero and which give you the inflationary potential. How much I have? 8 minutes? Okay. There is another model which actually is, I think, is better than the previous one, which essentially avoids this fine-tuning. And the reason why it avoids the fine-tuning is because it has a term linear in the Gostino and the term in which the Gostino is absent, which involve the same function, f of phi. And here there is this mysterious factor square root of 3. But this mysterious factor square root of 3 is exactly the factor which makes this model no scale, where you have an exact cancellation between an F term and this anti de Sitter negative term. You see that this formula here is exactly the cancellation. And this cancellation comes because of the ansatz of the superpotential. The superpotential is at most linear in S because S squared is 0. So when you have nilpotent fields, the only term you can have in a superpotential for the nonlinear realized supersymmetry is a linear term. Then this model is realistic because actually what happens is that the inflaton has a potential which is given here. It has a partner, which is an axion, but this axion is stabilized to zero, and it doesn't mix with phi, so it doesn't participate to inflation. This is the potential, so the inflationary potential would be this for A equals zero. And then this potential becomes zero at the exit of inflation, but this being zero doesn't mean that supersymmetry is not broken, because the F term of the Gostino is non-zero, and is calculable, is given by this formula here. And this is a model which has no scale structure and which has two supersymmetry breaking scale. And this supersymmetry breaking scale allow a cancellation of the large vacuum energy that you have during inflation. A model based on this structure, which exactly reproduces the Starobinsky model, is a model where the superpotential, namely this function f of phi, which appear here, is given by this formula here. So you see that in this model, the exponential factor which appear in the original Starobinsky model, it comes from the superpotential. It doesn't come from the kinetic term. The kinetic term, in fact, in this model have been taken canonical. So the kinetic term are here, are given, are canonical, given quadratic in the field. So the exponential factor has an origin which is due to the origin which is due to the superpotential factor. But this model precisely reproduces the Starobinsky model. So in some sense, there are two ways of having the Starobinsky model, or if you want, having a physically reliable potential. One is to have a kinetic term which is related to some non-trivial scalar manifold, as in R plus R square supergravity. And the other is to have instead a flat scalar potential, but to have a non-trivial superpotential which satisfies the constraint which are said here. In particular, this F must have a first derivative with zero, and it should be non-zero at the exit of inflation, because this is responsible for the potential at the exit of inflation, which is given by this term, because A is zero. So this essentially concludes my review on inflation and supersymmetry. The main lesson is that supersymmetry gives a very nice set of models which can reproduce the inflaton potential as it is given today in order to be not in conflict or to agree with the experiment. But it also gives options which, from the point of view of supersymmetry, they are different, because probably this different option will be selected if you try to make an ultraviolet completion of supergravity in some superstring theory. In superstring theory, the brain's dynamics is, for instance, the dynamics in which you can somehow control supersymmetry breaking. And so the study of whether some of these models are compatible with superstrings is an important message. On the other hand, the superstring may be not the only ultraviolet completion. So the results which are obtained in these studies may be more general than what one would expect by embedding this model in superstring context. So this is the end of my talk, and I thank you for it.
Thank you, Sergio. There is time for some questions. I see one hand here and another there. Can you bring the microphones? Okay, then I think doesn't matter.
Thanks, Sergio, for a very nice talk. I think, in my opinion, there is a serious problem in this entire approach. And the problem comes to my mind because you have broken supersymmetry at the Planck scale. So the gravitino mass at the Planck scale is of the order of Planck scale, essentially. Supersymmetry is badly broken in a cosmological context, in a time-dependent context. So how do you really satisfy the nilpotency? So you have to satisfy the nilpotency condition at each and every time evolution. And to my knowledge, I think it is impossible to do that.
Scale.
No, but you would imagine you have started the universe at the Planck scale, like what usual standard cosmologists would assume. At that scale, you have broken supersymmetry at the Planck scale. So how would you reconcile?
Only at that scale, not at the exit of inflation. The crucial
you have to think that it's not a static situation. It's an evolutionary situation, you see. Anyway, we can discuss.
Yeah, maybe it's a bit too technical. Ashtaka?
Thank you for this nice talk. So the question is about, just a general conceptual question, so one gets several models, some of which require a very lot of fine-tuning, the others don't. Is there a principle which selects the ones which don't require? I mean, from fundamental considerations, can we narrow down the choice, or is it at this stage of development one just says that, well, this is better because of the results I obtained, and therefore I discard the other ones.
Well, this is precisely what I was saying at the end of my talk. I mean, this model uses only the constraint of embedding the evolution in supergravity. Now, this model, from the point of view of supergravity, may be related to different ultraviolet completion. For instance, you don't believe in superstring theory. You may be interested to see whether these models are compatible with different ultraviolet completion. On the other hand, we have a manageable ultraviolet completion, which is string theory, and then that will give a restriction on these models. Mm. But the restrictions have not been really covered up to now. Mm.
So what is it that the model that requires fine-tuning does not satisfy?
Excuse me?
The previous model, which does require fine-tuning, what is it that it does not satisfy?
Well, I think any supersymmetric model, in some sense, requires a fine-tuning. Unless you fix some factor in this function, scalar potential and superpotential, which make the structure no-scale. No-scale means that there is a field cancellation for all values of the fields. But in some sense, you are still assuming this no-scale structure. Now, this no-scale structure could come from superstring theory, as in fact happens in this flux compactification. But really, a complete realistic model which has a unique extension in the ultraviolet, I don't think it has been found.
Any other question? Yes, one over there. Yeah, you have the microphone.
Supersymmetry promises to propose candidates for dark matter. Do you think it is possible? You're looking at inflation, so it's at a different scale. But do you think it is possible to construct a model that has a byproduct, as a possible candidate for dark matter, for example?
I think John Ellis is probably better suited than me to answer this question. But in principle, in these models, you have many candidates for dark matter. Of course, it would be nice if the gravitino would be dark matter, because that is the particle which is present in all these models, and it's actually present also in superstring theory, because as you know, the ultraviolet completion of superstring theory needs supersymmetry, actually, to cancel the vacuum energy. So in principle, the answer would be yes. Supersymmetry is a natural theory which gives some particle which have no interaction of the standard model type, which are there because of a symmetry reason. But if you ask me a specific model, I don't know how to answer.
Does John want to add something?
Yes.
Give him the microphone.
Yeah, no, I agree with Sergio that certainly you have a natural dark matter candidate, and I'll discuss this a little bit in my talk later on.
Okay, good, excellent. Okay, so if I don't see any more hands waving, we can thank Sergio again.